NDTV 24/7. Welcome to what promises to be a remarkable evening of conversation. Spiritual, logical, and I can promise you fun. Because it's easy to promise you all that when the guest is Sadhguru Jaggi Vasudev Ji. Sadhguru. Thank you very much for giving us the time. And it's obviously my charm that has brought all these people to fill up the hall on a Saturday evening. I just had to say, I'll have Sadhguru by my side. That's all that was needed. So thank you very much. Sadhguru, you know, my vantage point in life is news. Hard news, bad news mostly. So it's very difficult for me to relate to anything which is not hard news. You are a guru who helps people resolve their dilemmas. You use the example of Siri on GPS, that if you can trust a strange woman with telling you turn left, turn right, bike, why don't you need a guru in real life? Now play the guru in Kashmir for this young officer who has a dilemma. He is facing a stone throwing mob. He has a very small number of troops with him. Either he risks getting written off, or he risks firing at the mob, or he has an innovative idea. You know what I'm talking about. If he at that point found you, what would you tell him?
Namaskar to everyone. See, the decisions made on a battlefield or by a fighting force should be left to the last man there, because he is the one who is facing the bullets, he is the one who is sticking his neck out, he is the one who is standing there knowing fully well his wife could be widowed, his children could be orphaned, and still doing his job. None of us have any business to give him any advice. Not even me. I would not advise. I would say just do what's needed, because you're sticking your life out, you're risking everything. Who am I to tell you what you should do there?
So Lord Krishna would tell this officer, you take the call, I'll back you, I'll back your judgment.
I mean, his entire… he decided to be his charioteer, not a… you know, he's not fighting with him. Obviously he said, I'm backing you.
Right. So suppose the man who was put on the bonnet of the jeep, he were to come to you and he were to tell you that, Sadhguru, I am deeply wounded by this, I feel humiliated, I wasn't throwing stones, I had gone to vote, I am now traumatized. How do I recover from this?
See, you need to understand this. In a way, it may not be a full-scale battlefield, but it is a battlefield. It is a battlefield.
Right.
Those who have stones are throwing stones, those who have pellets are firing pellets, those who have bullets are firing bullets. Whatever you have, you are using, it is a battlefield. So on a battlefield, it is not always selective treatment. It happens, you are there, so it happens to you. You may be an innocent woman, you may be a totally innocent child, it doesn't matter who you are. You are in that place, things happen to you. Everybody must know this. So this is why maintaining peace in our minds, in our societies, in the world around us is of paramount importance, because once a battle happens, it's not selective, it'll happen to everybody. This is something we must know. This is why we must value what we have, some sense of peace happening right now in the world, wherever it is peaceful. We must see that we must preserve and endure this, because when battles happen, it is not going to, bullets are not going to choose that man who is guilty or that man who is evil. It just hits anybody. So we must understand this, and he must understand this too.
Is there more violence now in our society than before? Do people jump to beat somebody, kill somebody too easily?
No. I would say violence is at the minimum compared to the way human societies have been in the past. 100 years ago, 500 years ago, 1,000 years ago, how much violence was happening in human societies, how much is happening today is way less. Only problem with us today is the instruments of violence. What empowerment that's come to our hands, that today what you need a million strong army to kill a million people, but today it just takes a press of a button to do that. That is a tremendous…
And we know who has the button these days.
It seems they're taking away the button. They're only given the Twitter handle to them.
So, talk about India. Do we have more violence in India now on the street than we had before?
Not true. I think people may be feeling that way because violence enters their home through the television screen. Otherwise, violence happened and we did not know. We just read two people killed in the newspaper.
Sadhguru, that's only between 8 and 11 p.m. at night. Violence enters our homes on the TV screen.
So because the blood and gore is entering our homes, the impact of violence on us is big. I would say it is positive in one sense that all of us get a certain sense of allergy to violence, which I think is happening because we see it. Otherwise, we read two people killed this much in a newspaper. It was just two people killed, that's all it was. But now it all happens, even if you're blurring a few images, but there is blood on the street. This is sinking into us deeper, and we understand the value of being peaceful. It's real now, it's not just a number.
When you heard this wise judge talking, what was your reaction? That that peacock is our national bird because it remains lifelong brahmachari, and the peahen pecks at its tears. And in fact, he said produces Morya Morni. He didn't say, he didn't realize that Morni lays eggs. It's not a mammal. So, I mean, there is a judge who's been sitting on people's fortunes, maybe hanging them.
That was my first thought. In the last 25, 30 years of service, how many people must have shed tears?
But, Sadhguru, from where does this ignorance come? Normal educated people, doesn't even have to be a judge. Class 8 biology we all read.
See, normal educated people may be knowledgeable about the reproductive nature of the peacock. But obviously, there are too many things that they are also ignorant about. The judge is ignorant about the bird's ways of life, which is okay, because he's not passing a judgment on the peacocks at least. They don't come to the court. But in my experience and perception of life, I'm not so fearful about the evil on the planet, because it can be managed. The real danger is ignorance. That is the biggest problem. Mm. And ignorance can take a toll that no evil can take.
And if I may interrupt, it's because there is ignorance that fanaticism takes over.
See, the thing is, I think a lot of people are ignorant about the nature of fanaticism. why people, someone becomes a fanatic is because in some way, see, all of us do some stupid things, all right? Hello?
Yes.
You don't have to say it so loudly. If you do something idiotic right now, the very nature of human intelligence is such that tonight your intelligence will bother you, why did I do this? But if you get your stupidity scripture endorsed or God endorsed, then there's no turning back.
This is how it was written.
It can be done with enormous confidence.
Right.
You don't have to turn back and look. You can do most idiotic things with horrendous consequences to everybody, but you have endorsement from elsewhere.
Ye likha tha.
So, this I think is in a place where in the next 25 years, maximum 40 years, I see that the scriptures, the heavens will collapse. It is already collapsing in many ways. In individual minds, still people don't have the courage to voice it or it's not articulated in their mind yet, but it is collapsing. The very fact that I think in the last 25 or 30 years, the alcohol consumption in the country has gone up 1,000 times. This means heavens are collapsing. So before everybody becomes a drunkard or a drug addict, it's important that raising of the consciousness happens, that we are able to teach you how to sit here totally blissed out and stoned out by yourself without any substance. Because otherwise, in the next 50 years, you will see 90% of the human population will be in some kind of a chemical. Already it's getting there very rapidly, either prescribed or otherwise. United States, for example, I'm taking United States as an example because it is considered to be the most affluent nation. Either as an individual or a society or a nation, you seek affluence for two fundamental reasons. In the early stages, it's a choice of nourishment. That's what you're seeking. You can eat what you want. The next stage is a choice of lifestyles. This is the only reason why you're seeking affluence. Now a nation becomes far more affluent than the rest of the world, you have a choice of nourishment and you have an enormous choice of lifestyle, and 70% of the population is on prescription medication. There's a $3 trillion bill on the healthcare. A lot of people are predicting, if at all, if anything sinks United States, it is going to be their healthcare bill. So with such a choice of nourishment and lifestyle, why the hell are you not healthy? 70% are on prescription medication, another 30% are buying off the back street anyway. So prescribed medicines and drugs, everything, chemicals to do everything, to create an experience within you, either of health or peace or joy or bliss, you need a chemical. This is on the rise simply because in people's minds, they may not be conscious, heaven is collapsing. For a long time, we have managed people, it doesn't matter you're miserable here, when you go there,
you'll be fine.
Everything will be fantastic, okay? That everything will be fantastic somewhere else is slowly collapsing in everybody's mind. So here they're trying to make it fantastic because nobody taught them how. They're trying to drink themselves to a fantastic state or drug themselves to a fantastic state. So fundamentally what they're looking for is heaven. They may be hitting the bottle, they may look like a drug addict, they may be rejects in the society, but the man who goes to the temple and the man who goes to the bar are seeking the same thing. They want their life to become fantastic.
Since you said ask three questions, any scripture will collapse. One question that will make the Hindu scripture collapse, one question that will make the Christian scriptures collapse, and one question that will make the Muslim scriptures collapse.
You are trying to have me killed.
I am your accomplice. I'll die first and go to heaven.
I want to ask you an uncomfortable question. The Sanatan Dharma seems to be in a lot of trouble these days. We have people in the name of books and in the name of Hinduism killing other people because of cows. And you know, we see this now across the country. So when you say there's less violence today, on what basis are you saying this? And are you worried that the whole concept of the Sanatan Dharma is now in in danger?
Am I worried? No, I am not. I am not worried because first of all, let's understand this. Dharma does not mean a religion as it's being interpreted today. Dharma means the law. So we have different kinds of laws. We said in a family, a husband has one kind of dharma, wife has another kind of dharma, in the society this kind of dharma, Raja dharma, all kinds of dharma. Different laws which govern different activities in our life. In this one particular law we mentioned is Sanatan Dharma, that means it's an eternal law. That means obviously not concerned with the society, because social laws are evolving, changing as per situations. Eternal law means it concerns something very fundamental within us, which doesn't change. So we don't have to be ever concerned, will the eternal laws will get lost somewhere? They will not get lost. As long as human beings are there, it's always there. Nobody need to worry that Sanatan Dharma will go away. Well, it may go away the way you believe it is, and that's a good thing. About lot of people getting killed because of cows. I'm sorry, but you put few riders that I must answer truthfully. You must also get ready to digest truth, because it's hard to digest truth many times. I don't know what is your engagement with people. I have a huge engagement with large masses of people on a daily basis. I don't see any such violence anywhere. You see this violence only in the television screens, largely. I'm not saying it's not at all happening. Obviously it's happening, that's why it's being reported, all right. But saying that it's taking isolated incidents and saying it's widespread is a very wrong idea. You must understand, more than Sanatan Dharma or any cow protection or whatever, there are economic interests. This is a country, for everything we are fighting, because for everything there is a competition, for everything there is a scarcity. There are economic interests, and when they find some holy reason to exploit something for economic interest, they will go all out to do it. And many, many times it's been found out, people who did these things are found a convenient way of stealing somebody's cows, found a convenient way of taking away somebody's consignment of animals for their own use. All these aspects are there. Yes, there are some hotheads who will rise. When hot air balloons rise, you have to just lower the heat and bring them down. This is the business of the government, and I think they will do it. Law and order, it is just a law and order situation.
So you certainly disapprove of this. Gaurakshak taking the law into their hands.
See,
and
whether you are a gau slaughterer or a gau rakshak, you can't take the law into your hand. You understand? Whoever the hell you are, you cannot take the law into your hand. But having said that, there is one problem. See, we make laws for which we don't have the courage to enforce. Either we must withdraw those laws or we must enforce the law. You make a law and you don't enforce because of political reasons and other sensitivities, somebody else takes it up upon himself to enforce the law in his own crude way. So this is something, as a society we must look at it, not just the government, as a society, all of us as citizens of this nation, we should look at it.
These days we are in dilemma about two monks and two yogis. I'm coming from Banaras and I met one monk who is Sankat Mocha's Mahant, Mahant Vishambharnathji. And there is another Mahant who is ruling the state of UP. One spews, you know, hatred and all kinds of communal disharmony. The other Mahant speaks the language of Sankat Mochan, far more liberal, far more peaceful language. Which Mahant, Sadhguruji, should we adopt?
I didn't know they were available for adoption.
In fact, one of them went around the state asking for votes, which is adoption, and he got adopted.
Once someone has become, in a democratic society, has become an elected leader, then what he believes, what he thinks within himself, all these things are irrelevant to you. What he's going to do every day, you must pay attention. If he's doing something wrong, we have instruments to stop him. If he's doing it right, we must support him. That's about it. You don't have to adopt any political leader. If they're doing the right thing for the nation, we must support them. If they're doing wrong thing for the nation, we must criticize that. If we can stop it, there are instruments in a democracy through which we can stop it in so many different ways. If not immediately, we can. So this is what we should do as responsible citizens, not have my pet politician. No, you should not have a pet politician of your own. The politician that you have elected, is he working for the nation or is he working for himself, is all that you have to see, first step. The second step is, does he have the breadth of the mind and intelligence and competence to create what the nation needs? Does he understand the heartbeat of this nation? That is the second thing. If these two things are happening within a politician or a leader, it's our business to support him. If that is not there, it's our business to change him.
Sadhguru, namaskar. My name is Mahrukh Inayat. I work with Shekhar for the print. I have two quick questions. The first one is, do you believe that rapists and terrorists should be hanged? Capital punishment for rapists and terrorists? And secondly, our government has criminalized homosexuality in this country. Do you think that section, that law should be changed? Thank you.
See, the laws in any particular nation are made at certain times of its growth and its evolution. Right now, when the nation is continuously being threatened by terrorist action, And the sovereignty of the nation itself is under threat, not in one particular area, in many places. We need some stringent laws. Fundamentally, am I for legal killing? I am not for killing of any kind. Whether you kill an ant or a human being, I don't like it, okay? But without killing, you are not able to exist, so I am saying at least please minimize it. Don't do it beyond what is needed.
And not extrajudicially.
That is not even in question.
Not even a question, yes.
Even killing of an ant or an insect or a worm, let it be to the minimum, to the extent it is a must for you, not beyond that, because this planet is not just made for you and me. This is the most retrograde idea that has entered human mind, is every other creature is here to serve us. No, they have a life of their own. They have a complete life of their own. I have spent so much time in the jungles of southern India. If you observe birds and animals and other things, you must see the level of organization and involvement they have in their life. A complete life of their own, okay? So they are not here to serve us, they are here to live their life. An ant does not think he is an insignificant life, an ant thinks he is the most significant life on this planet. So having said that, but the nation is in a certain level of evolution. Just trying to transplant laws from nations which are in a completely different state and bring it down here and say, ban this, ban that, take off this, may not work for our country. You must understand this. It's very easy to say, ban the capital punishment. But you ask the families of victims who have not just seen crime, they've seen brutality of the worst kind, unimaginable levels of brutality, which all of you have been reporting and talking about. You think of their families when that man walks tomorrow on the street, how they feel. You must have some way, especially for a terrorist. Capital punishment is not a deterrent because he's coming to die, all right? He wants to die. He doesn't want to live, he wants to die. So a man who wants to die, you have to help him.
What about rapists? Rapists, she asked.
See, in the country already they made this distinction. In the rarest of rare, I think we should keep it for now. Is this a permanent law? No, I don't believe it should be a permanent law. As a society, as we evolve, as the situations become less and less and become negligible, then we can say, okay, we can feed him and keep him in the prison.
Right.
But right now, I think it's necessary. But at the same time, there is another face to this killing or threatening a capital punishment for the rapist is, generally the only witness to the rape is the victim. The best thing is not to leave her alone, leave her alive, you know. This will become the trend, this is a danger. So threatening them with too much capital punishment, we're going to hang you, we're going to hang you, on the news channels they're saying we got to hang him, we have to castrate him. This must go. This must be done gently in the process of law.
Otherwise he'll be tempted to kill the
He
victim.
Will be tempted, not tempted, he wants to kill because that's if you leave her alone, that's the only way he can be caught because that's the only witness there is. So one thing is you're kind of pushing the society in a way that, you know, people will get killed. We must understand this, we are a society in transition. Please, I want you to listen to this little carefully because immediately you can make conclusions, oh, he's supporting this, I'm not supporting anything. We must understand, we are a society in transition. There was a time, at the age of 14, a girl would get married, at the age of 17, 18, a boy would get married. Let's face it, there are hormonal drives in every human being, all right? Unless they've transcended that and gotten somewhere out of something in their life. Every other human being, normal human being has these things. Now they were getting married and this was kind of settled there. Now because of our education process and individual aspirations, on an average, I think girls in India are getting married at 21, 22. Boys are getting married 25, 26. And a whole lot of them have leaving their natural habitat of rural existence and moving into Mumbai. I want you to just think about a guy who just moved into Mumbai from somewhere, some remote place of the country. I know you will thrash him, but suppose he finds a job. Who is going to get him married? Where is he going to get married? If he lived in that community, his parents, his mama, his chittappa, his chacha, all these people would work to see that he is married. He says, no, I don't want to get married. Every girl says, I don't want to get married. They will say, no, you must, you must, you must, and somehow fix it up. You must understand, this is not about that. This is about handling fundamental human needs. Societies are driven by human needs, isn't it? Now he lands up in the city, where does his sexual drive go, I'm asking? Where does it find expression? So we need to have a debate. Are we ready for premarital engagement? Or do we want to get married at 14, 15? We must have an open debate about this. We don't even want to talk about it and we only want to hang the rapist. It's not going to work. You must understand he is also a victim of times. He doesn't know how to handle himself. I am not trying to approve his rape, but have you created an atmosphere where you will turn every young man into a sage? Have you created that? No. Have you provided him an outlet? No. You just think if you close your eyes, it gets handled. It doesn't get handled. It's finding expression in ugly ways. So we need to look at our life. Either we consciously transit with minimum amount of aberration, or it will happen in compulsive ways somehow, in clandestine ways. Even today, I'm sure, even in reasonably well-to-do homes, if any hormonal issue of a boy or a girl means they will handle it in a clandestine way, not in an open way, because we're still not willing to face the human biology straight in the face. We need to do that.
And the other question about the Section 377 of IPC which criminalizes homosexuality.
See, we inherited a whole lot of laws from the British. This is called as the buggery law, even today in the law book. So this came from that time. And what do I think about it? I think this also needs a debate. not protests on the street, not trying to make sexual orientation as an identity for a human being. It should not happen. This is unfortunately happening. But what one does in their bedroom is never my business. I never see it as my business.
And should not be the state's business also.
State will not know either.
Right.
State has no means to know unless you want to display it on the street. State doesn't know, isn't it?
Namaskar Sadhguru, lots of respect and regards to you. My name is Kajal and I'm an actor. And my question to you is, could you please explain the meaning of intuition? And does intuition have anything to do with spirituality? Is there any connection?
Well, it will get too complicated. See, we must understand this. A spiritual process means it is not a journey. I have never said that. You're reading other books. Spiritual process means it's about turning inward. If you're turning inward, what is the distance between what is you and what is you? You and you, there is no distance. When there is no distance, how do you make a journey? It's a thing going on for a long time. That is because people have convoluted ideas of what is spiritual process. Always they told you spiritual process means is about self-knowing. Knowing yourself, maybe you're taking a long time, but still you're not covering distance, isn't it? Because there's no distance to cover. So definitely it cannot be a journey. To make a journey, you need distance. You may be taking time, but there is no distance to cover. Let's be clear about that. About becoming irresponsible, about if somebody is going through a divorce. See, if you want to divorce somebody, spiritual excuse is a very respectable excuse. You divorcing your wife or husband because of an affair is a bad thing in the society. But you're divorcing because for higher purpose is a very...
So go to an ashram for a couple of months and you are done.
So somebody may be using that as a ruse, but essentially spiritual process means it's something that you do within yourself, not something that you do around yourself. What you do within yourself in no way demands that you have to be in this place or that place. For a certain moment of consideration, maybe you want to withdraw for a small period of time. That you do for many things. You want to take an examination, don't you withdraw from your social sphere because you want to study? Similarly, you withdrew for a week or a month. This doesn't mean you've given up life. So this entire idea of spiritual process means I must go to the Himalayan cave. I'm giving you first-hand information, Hayden and Dani. You must know this because this is a...
He'll build a tower there also.
There is a business possibility, that's why I'm saying. To withdraw to the mountain caves, all the caves are taken. There is really no accommodation left there. So in Mumbai, if you build cave apartments, you may...
Good idea.
So you can move into the cave if you wish, but essentially you must understand this. Spiritual process means turning inward. Turning inward means maybe I want to close my eyes and sit for a while. But now if you are such a stupid set of family that if I close my eyes you think I'm going away somewhere, definitely I feel like going away. Otherwise there's no need to go away anywhere. Spiritual process is about becoming all-inclusive. This is not about exclusivity, this is about becoming all-inclusive. So where is the question of going away? It's a larger engagement. So there is no such need. But if individual people have needs that they feel they've made a mistake, they correct themselves, that's not because of spirituality, because of their own individual choices. About intuition. See, intuition essentially means a different level of computing, not a different level of perception. Spiritual process or mysticism means moving into a different level of perception. For this you have to enhance your perception. Intuition is just a different level of computing.
I'm Pachi Karkarna. As Indians, we are great believers in religion, faith, call it what you will. We also have spiritual leaders like you. But today, all of our religion is being politicized. So do you think that you're abrogating your responsibility in not speaking about it? You're even giving away your constituency.
No, did I not speak about it? What is this?
No, you didn't. You didn't really say
that.
Tell
me, what should I speak?
Yeah, no, but really that should our spiritual leaders jump into the fray and tell politicians, this is not the religion that is ours and you stay out of it because this is really not what religion or faith is about.
What makes you think it's not being said?
It's not being
said. You want me to say it on a microphone? No, when you want somebody to receive something, you have to tell them in a certain way, the way they get it. And it is being said. What makes you think it's not said? Wherever there's an opportunity, I'm definitely saying it.
Sadhguru, I have reserved all my questions. In fact, this audience was so brilliant, I had to do no work. You can see that, you know, I wasn't caught out. But there's one question which has bothered me, and I'll just misuse my position here to steal time. You said, when I heard you for the first time in Jaipur, you said death actually will come as a big relief to most people. And I asked you a question as to what you meant and you explained it. But if death is really such a big relief to people, then are we to justify suicidal thoughts? Let me be done with it. What ho gaya? Enough.
I don't know what I said on that day. Maybe I said your death will come as a relief to everybody.
That will be, that Sadhguru will be abetment of suicide. you did no such thing. No.
Yes, see the thing is, life is beautiful and very sweet. If you know how to keep yourself well, this is a beautiful life and very sweet and very fantastic. Not everybody is experiencing it that way, unfortunately, but it is possible for every human being to do this much, that your experience of life on this planet, you can make it very pleasant. But I want you to just imagine yourself, you're sitting right here doing the same job, this Sadhguru will die, another will come, all kinds of people, terrorist will come, you'll interview him, politician will come, you'll interview him, all kinds of people, you'll interview him and go on. Let's say next 10,000 years, you're still on print. You will want a relief, isn't it? And when it becomes long enough, and if you see the process of life, not just on the surface, if you see the nature and process of life, let me ask you this otherwise. Did you enjoy your school?
Yes.
But were you eager to go to college?
Sometimes I was, sometimes I wasn't, and sometimes I went to college but bunked.
That's fine.
That was most of the time.
Just because, for whatever reason, because you could bunk, because you could do so many things, whatever. When you were in school, even if this process of school was very pleasant and wonderful for you, suppose it was, would you still not want to leave the school and go to the next stage? The same thing with this.
Right.
It doesn't matter how wonderful it is. The very nature of the human being is such, you always want to go to the next stage, whatever that is, isn't it?
And come back.
If you could, whether we want you to come back or not, leave to us.
I think on that note, you know, much as everybody would want all the 30 hours here, get themselves properly.
I am not coming back.
Properly re-engineered, I don't think we'll hold you for 30 hours, Sadhguru. Thank you very much.
You've been so
wonderful and so generous with your time. And thank you very much. This has been such a great conversation that I think we can carry on doing it every week. So thank you very much for watching Off the Cuff or OTC, and come back for our next edition. Thank you.